This is the Telegraph Cycling Podcast. I'm Lionel Birnie. Richard Moore and Daniel Friebe will be back next week. This week I'm in Belgium. It's a chilly November evening in Ghent, Belgium. I'm in the Citadelpark, just a short walk from the centre of the town. It's the opening night of the Ghent 6 Day, and I'm at the Kuipke track to see Mark Cavendish's competitive return to action, as he possibly has his eyes on racing at the Rio Olympics in 2016. For fans of 6 Day racing, this is basically the home of the discipline. It's the last of the thriving 6 Days, I suppose. Over the last few years, the 6 Day scene has dwindled somewhat, but the Ghent 6 is still alive and kicking, and the Kuipke Park is kind of the beating heart of 6 Day racing. I've just entered the Velodrome now. I'm in the area just underneath the steeps. It smells of hot dogs and beef burgers and chips. I can see all the beer stands here. This is where the crowds gather. There's probably half an hour or so before the senior race starts. Mark Cavendish, of course, is partnering the local favourite, the Ghent rider, Iljo Keisse, in this year's race. Keisse has won it several times now. The Ghent 6 has been going since 1922. The first edition was won by Marcel Buis and Oscar Egg. And 6 Day racing back then was a very different kettle of fish. They raced constantly for 6 days and nights. It's a little bit more humane than that now. They'll be on the track at 8:30 and they'll carry on through to 1 a.m. So it's still a long night for the riders. The velodrome's already buzzing with activity. I'm about to walk down the stairs now underneath the track, and then I'll emerge back in the track centre in just a moment. Cavendish has raced here before a couple of times, first with Rob Hales, I think in 2005, and then in 2007 with Bradley Wiggins. Born in Ghent, of course. His father was one of the stars of the 6 Day scene in the 70s. Gary Wiggins, that is. And Bradley Wiggins actually won this event in 2003 with Matthew Gilmore. I'm actually just arriving as Mark Cavendish and Shane Archbold make their way into the velodrome. So any cheers you hear won't be for me. Already I can hear the man on the PA. And it's already very warm in here. It'll get hotter and louder as the evening goes on. Quite a steep walk up into the track centre. And here I am, and my first impressions are just how compact it is in here. The track centre's already packed with people drinking beers, working my way through the crowd a little bit. People are up there in the seats. The crowd is in, ready for the action. But the track itself is only 166 metres. And if you've been to Manchester or Glasgow or London, those tracks are 250 metres. And so it really gives the impression of the riders here racing around the inside of a washing machine drum almost. The banking is incredibly steep, much steeper than it is at Manchester or London or any of the other velodromes that are used for the World Cup or World Championship. The riders are beginning to make their way into the centre of the velodrome, where they will take their places in their little custom-made cabins that are just inside the track centre. That's basically where they'll base themselves when they're not on the track racing. Small cramped spaces, not ideal places to try and grab a bit of relaxation time between events. But the 6 Day culture has evolved this way over, you know, decades of the races. And I think what the Ghent 6 sums up to me is it's where sport meets theatre, entertainment, and also a bit of the kind of stag or hen do culture. It's a place where people come for a good night out. The racing is entertaining. It's designed to be that way. And the people who are here really drink in the atmosphere. In fact, they are the atmosphere. So here we are. The Ghent 6 is about to get underway.
The Telegraph Cycling Podcast. Interviews and analysis. We've got the big talking points covered.
Yeah.
section van het Kuipke. Nu lang applaus voor Iljo Keisse en Mark Cavendish. Met een nieuwe Gentse buurtenvader in Daniel Turbot. Die zijn...
Okay, well, I'm in the seats in the home straight now. I've just taken a seat. The racing is about to get underway. We've just watched the ceremonial start, which was performed by Felice Gimondi, the great Italian rider, winner of the 1965 Tour de France. He fired the starting gun, and I'm with Patrick Lefebvre, the boss of the Amiga Pharma Quickstep team. And as Felice was about to fire the gun, Patrick, you said, don't shoot him, referring to Mark Cavendish, your star rider who's here. And I suppose my first question is, are you 100% happy that Mark Cavendish is taking part in the 6 days this winter?
Well, happy is maybe not the right word. I'm a little bit worried because 6 days on a small track like this, only 166 meters, is a little bit dangerous. If you see how steep the corners are, and of course the core business of Mark Cavendish for us is still winning races in the road season.
Is it good for him though to have some competitive, this is like super training surely for the start of the winter, it gets him into very good shape when he does this kind of riding?
Because last year was a very tough year for him. He did Giro Tour, was very tired on the end of the season, let him go a little bit too much, taking too much weight. This season he stopped after Tour of Britain and kept his shape as possible. And we thought it was maybe not a bad idea to let him do 6 days of Ghent and the 6 days of Zurich to prepare the season.
He is one of the best bike handlers there is, and of course he was brought up in the track. He spent hours and hours on the track in Manchester. But the point you make about it being so tight here, it's a very small track, a very steep banking, and it can be dangerous racing.
Yeah, but you know, training in England or in Belgium can be very dangerous as well. If somebody opens his door of his car or coming out the crossroads and taking over the car, it's maybe even more dangerous than here.
What place do you think six-day racing has in cycling at the moment? Because Ghent is still extremely popular. There's a big crowd here. It's opening night. It will be even busier towards the weekend. There's a whole culture around it with everybody enjoying the beer and the fruit, but it's not so strong elsewhere. 40 years ago we had a very strong six-day circuit. Do you think it is struggling to stay alive a little bit?
Unfortunately, it's changed because 40 years ago the riders didn't have the salary that they have today, and they had to do, even at the max, had to do in the winter the 6 days to gain some money. Now it changed, they're well paid people, and unfortunately this culture, I'm afraid, gonna die.
Do you enjoy watching the racing? Will you be here all week keeping an eye on Mark, or just here for the first night?
Oh, I'm here today. Tomorrow evening is his trophy, Belgium trophy, so I will be not here. I will be here on Thursday, on Friday, and maybe on Sunday.
And do you enjoy watching the racing, or are you too invested in Mark Cavendish to really enjoy?
Yes, I come here a very long time. I was training myself on this small track 40 years ago, and I was a lot of times in the middle where all the crowd are, and drinking some beers.
Well, that's the place to be, so I think I'm going to head down there now. So thanks very much, Patrick.
Enjoy.
And I hope your boy stays
Enjoy.
Safe. So the first race of the evening is underway. It's a 120-lap team points race, and there are sprints after every 10 laps. I think they're coming up to the third sprint at the moment. Mark Cavendish and Iljo Keisse are in fifth place at the moment with 5 points. It's all very early days. If you've not been to a six-day race before, these Madison-style races are kind of the bread and butter. There'll be maybe three or four of these kind of events over the course of the evening. The racing started at 8:30, and it will go on to 1 in the morning. Before that, there was a race for the under-23s, so the crowd have been in here since about 6:30. And it's pretty close to capacity. There's a few empty seats at the moment, but the centre of the track is jam-packed with people, most of whom are enjoying a beer.
alle dagen een feest.
Right, could I have a beer, please? One beer, please. Thank you very much.
Cavendish and Keisse.
Thank you. No. I'm getting some stick for walking around with my headphones here. But as you've just heard, I've ordered another beer. Trying to squeeze through the crowd. The can-can music, not sure it's terribly appropriate for the elimination race, but it does seem to work. They're kind of giving me the whole thing kind of galloping horses tempo.
We gaan rechtstreeks naar kijken. Hier is de bel. Laatste ronde voor de volgende aanvulling.
Cavendish is going to try and come over the top. Doesn't look like he's got the legs for it, but very close on the line. Very close on the line. But the boost into Kettle have won that. Big punch of the air. That's popular with the Belgian fans, certainly. Cavendish doesn't like being beaten, even here. So De Bruijs and De Ketelo are off to a good start. They've won the team in elimination ahead of Mark Cavendish and Iljo Keisse. And the atmosphere is really starting to heat up in here now, as is the temperature. A lot of people in the track centre making it very warm. Well, I've been welcomed into one of the cabins by Etienne Elegance, who's a veteran soigneur, been a soigneur, I gather, for around 45 years at the Ghent 6, something like that, so Gary Beckett tells me anyway. And for those who have never been in the cabins before, it's not exactly glamorous in here. It's very small space to work. This is where the riders will freshen up, change clothes between races. What else goes on down here, Etienne? Because it's very small space for the riders to try and get out of the madness a little bit.
Yeah, this cabin is actually for this week, the second place where they stay after the hotel. We have downstairs, we have another cabin where we give massage, but the whole evening, every time after the race, where they have sweat and everything, you have to change the tricots. So we wash them with cologne, we freeze them up. And then afterwards they put it in the dryer because they change every time after each number they did. I have to change them. After the chase we have a small massage. Like you see, you got everything. He set his small stand with the drinks and energy gels and all those things. A bucket to wash themselves with the names. Everything is marked that every rider takes his own drink and everything. The same with the grease. Here is grease with the name on it. Like for the hygiene, if everybody takes with the same spoon, they put spoon with grease in on the chamois. So for the hygiene, each had his own bucket with the name on it.
So you could get an infection if you used the same grease. And that's to lubricate the underside of the rider's derriere, I suppose, because they're in the saddle a lot. It's hard work, isn't it, riding? They're doing probably 3-4 hours at high intensity on the tracks, aren't they?
Yeah, and especially when you have a small one. That means that the bends are steeper, so you'll get more pressure, and more pressure means that you got more pressure also on the where you sit. And then it's necessary that every time after a big chase, you put some extra grease, because the grease goes away in the chamois. So most important is, if you don't have it, greasy, mm-hmm. then you get burnt.
Yeah.
Or smaller the track is, or more pressure you get in the bands. So it's so important, because it's very delicate. If you get injured there and it's open, it's impossible to race. So that's one of the most important things, is the hygiene. We have to do and then see that they don't get open.
So the hygiene and making sure that there's no build-up of friction. Very easy to get a saddle sore on night one and make the rest of the week very, very painful.
Exactly. And it's not in the past, we got it already, even with big riders, if you have a small injury on the street, you can come from your saddle, but here they are fixed on the saddle. If they race for 1 hour, they're always the pressure. Exactly here, it's 160 meters, so it's so important.
And they change the tricot. I must say tricot, not jersey, because in six-day racing, the name is a tricot. Yeah. They change every time because obviously they get sweat, and then that will get cold, and then they might get a chill.
Yeah, that's also important that they don't get cold. They're sweating because the temperature, you see a lot of spectators, full house, and when this small area here, and they're sweating. They're really, really, really wet. So as soon as they come down, we change them, we clean them. The tricots and everything goes in the dryer. And we have three tricots, so every time we dry it. And after the evening session, so tonight at 1 o'clock, then everything is going to be washed in the machine. So I take it home because I don't stay here. I live in Antwerp, so every day I drive up. If I am in Germany or something, then we stay in the track, but now I go home.
And over the years that you've been doing this job, who are some of the most famous riders you've worked with?
This is my 36th winter season. So I started with Rick van Linde. I was with him. So I did my first 6 day with Willy de Geest, Rick van Linde. It's 36 years ago. So, and then I stayed in, and then I worked with Francesco Moser. I did some 6 days with Doyle, with Clark, but mostly with Pincoletto, Buffy, Villa, Martinello, so a lot of, Lombardi, Robert Bartko. So I got a lot of years with the rider who did the longest career was Villa. He was 19 years pro, so I worked 19 years in the winter with him.
And this year, who are you looking after? You've got two teams, have you?
Yeah, I have here the Russian guys, and then I have also Lampater, and then I have Grassmann, two German riders.
And if you had to explain six-day racing to a cycling fan who's never seen it before, how would you describe it?
So, mostly this public in Ghent, they know exactly because they're used. But if you never saw a 6 day, you come here, it's confusing because you're taking lap, lose lap. You have to watch it. If you just have one moment, no attention, then you lose. So for the spectators, sometimes it's not easy. For us, it's easy because we know the system, how it works, like in medicinal thing. But if you don't know, it's what's wrong. So.
And there's a mixture of races, isn't there? There's the points races and the Madison chases, and like this is the elimination race at the moment. But then there's also a bit more theatre with the Derny races as well. It's a mixture of sport and entertainment, isn't it?
Yeah, it's also very hard for the riders because you say 6 day, but here they go from the start till 1 o'clock, only the first two evenings, then it's till 2 o'clock. They're always up, down, so it's it's pretty hard this 6 day because if you don't come with any good condition, you know, a few years ago when Cavendish came here with Wiggins, so they were not prepared very well, and the first chase they were losing 9 laps. So you see, Cavendish is in a much better condition than a few years ago, eh?
And of course, he's with the big hometown favourite. Keisse is from Ghent. He's won here several times. Very popular with the crowds. Is that one of the things that keeps it going? Because the six-day circuit is not thriving everywhere. There are races disappearing, but Ghent just seems like it goes from strength to strength, really.
We still have they're not money anymore, but those who are here now, 6 days, I think they will continue. But in the past, I did sometimes 15, 16, 6 days in the winter, and now for this year we got six. So,
and is the money going down for the riders? I guess that means the money's going down for the soigneurs and the mechanics also.
No, we work for the same price.
Your price never goes down, is that right?
No, we're working already 15, 20 years on the same price, but everything went up. Like if we have to buy everything from the cream and chamois cream and or cologne and everything. Also the expenses when I have to go to Copenhagen, I have to drive to Copenhagen, I have to take the boat. So you have a lot of expenses. So, but I also work in summer with Topsport Baloise, because you can't live anymore only from those few 6 days. It's impossible. It's good for the winter time, but you need a road team also. So, and then I also go with the national team. I do the World Cups and World Championship, and then a few, five, 6 days races with top sport.
But you love the atmosphere here. There's something about the place, isn't there? This building is it has so much history.
It's a monument. And also for me coming here every time, because it's hard, because from here after this session tonight, they're eating and they go to the hotel, but then I have to drive 80 kilometers for my home. So then I do the laundry and everything. I wash till the laundry is done, and then I go to sleep, and then tomorrow I have to be here just in the afternoon to start the massage and everything. But
and what do the riders do during the day? Presumably they will lie in, have a sleep in a little bit, but then during the day, will they ride on the road at all, or will they?
No, sometimes in the afternoon they're rolling half hour, 45 minutes, and then they stay here, they get massage, they take a rest, and then the evening starts.
Well, your boys must be doing quite well, because this is the elimination race, and they're not just arriving here now. So I'll get out of your way and let you do your job. Thank you, Etienne. Hello, one beer, please. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Sex bomb. You're my sex bomb. You can give it to me when I need to call. I'm sex bomb, sex bomb. You're my sex bomb. Baby, you can turn me on.
Well, that hum like a mosquito in the background is the sound of six Derny bikes whizzing round the track, and it strikes me that it's a bit like the wacky races here. There's six slightly portly men in blue jackets, all on motorised bikes, whizzing round, having the time of their lives, and they're each going to pace one of the riders in this next 60-lap Derny race. This is where the sort of theatre takes over, because these races are for entertainment as much as they are for the standings. I mean, they do count towards the standings, but really the Derny driver is in control. I mean, he's the one setting the pace, and there is a little bit of orchestration. Sometimes it's a bit more obvious than other times. The Derny drivers kind of put on a bit of a show, really, and the riders behind them play their part. That's just how it is. But they're about to get started. The cyclists are rolling around, about to get onto the wheels of the Derny riders. Just a few things that struck me watching the first half before we heard from the wonderful Nick Kahn, who finished with a Tom Jones medley. Sadly, we didn't have time to play all of that. It was beyond words. But the conventions and the traditions that are here, the riders, they all have numbered jerseys. The tradition still remains that they tuck their jerseys, or tricots. I must stop calling them jerseys.
Here's the Derny racers from vanavond.
They tuck them into their shorts, and that harks back to the days when they were very baggy. And so they tuck them into their shorts so that they couldn't be either grabbed by the riders or just flap around their waist. So that tradition still remains. I mean, there's no reason why they couldn't wear skin suits now, but they don't. So here we go, the Derny race is about to get started. And here we go.
Shane Archbold for the
10 laps to go.
So 10 laps to go in the Derny race. And they've been racing for about 9.5 minutes now. The clock is counting down in the background. The Derny drivers are on their motorised bikes. They have to pedal, but I don't think there's an awful lot of effort going into it. I think I've missed my calling. This looks like the perfect job for me, being a Derny driver. The lead has changed hands several times throughout the race. Everyone's had a go in the lead so far, but it's hotting up now, and it looks like De Power is in the lead at the moment. And he's got a little bit of a gap. But really, my tip to win is Kenny de Ketelaere, Belgian favourite, currently in third place, 6 laps to go. And his Derny driver is taking him up towards the front, gradually closing the gap to the leading two teams. There's a bit of to-ing and fro-ing at the front. But I think these two out in front. Yeah, Kenny de Ketelaere is nodding to his Birnie driver to lift the pace a bit, and they close down the gap very quickly. Four laps to go, and they overtake and move up into second place, and now they've got the leading rider, Mark Hester, in sight. They're coming over the top. Two laps to go now, timed it perfectly, almost as if it was scripted. I can't believe it. Nevertheless, they are moving incredibly quickly, obviously with the motorbike driver in front. They're not hitting the wind. Three teams neck and neck. Maybe it's not going to be a stage of it. Yeah, Kenny De Ketteler wins it. Very close to the finish between the first three teams. They were almost photo finish tight there over the line, but Kenny De Ketteler wins. Entertaining spectacle. Slightly bemusing at times, perhaps, but we've got another couple of those races coming up, and I think Mark Cavendish is in the next one, so I'm looking forward to that. Well, in all my years covering cycling, I've never seen what I've just witnessed. A cat got onto the track here at Ghent. It ran across the boards and up the banking, jumped into the crowd. People in the stand were trying to catch it, and eventually a man caught the cat and took it out, and presumably, I don't know, gave it to the hot dog vendors or something. I don't know. No, that's a terrible, terrible suggestion. But how on earth a cat got in here, I don't know. One beer, please.
What?
One beer, please.
A beer? Yeah,
thank you.
Oh, shit.
Thank you very much. Thank
you. You're listening to the Telegraph Cycling Podcast. Tweet us at cycling_podcast.
So it's the morning after the night before, and we're in the car park of our hotel in Ghent, just getting bikes ready for a little ride. I've hooked up with a couple of friends. Andy, hello Andy.
Hello there.
And Simon, who's faffing, the typical pre-ride faff for Simon. I don't know what he's doing, but... We all feel pretty sprightly after the opening night of the Ghent 6, which is perhaps a little surprising. We've got the winter bikes out, mud guards. It's actually dry today, although it is cold, noticeably colder than back home in the UK, actually. We're going to negotiate our way out of the centre of Ghent, try and find the Schelde Canal, which has got a cycling path all the way along it to Oudenaarde. And then when we get to Oudenaarde, we're probably going to have some lunch and a look round the Tour of Flanders Museum. Oudenaarde is where the Tour of Flanders finishes these days, and there's a museum there, so this is a bit like a school trip, really, but perhaps a bit more fun than some of the school trips I went on. I once went on a school trip to a banana ripening factory, so it would certainly be more interesting than that. And if we have time this afternoon after our trip around the museum, we'll try and ride over to the Old Quadamont, which is one of the famous cobble climbs from the Tour of Flanders and Het Nieuwsblad and other races like that. So it's time to roll out. We've cycled down from Ghent, our hotel's in Ghent, and we've come down the Schelde Canal to Oudenaarde, and currently we are in the cafe at the Tour of Flanders Museum. Lovely ride out, wasn't it, chaps? 22 miles, all on cycle path, virtually no traffic.
No traffic whatsoever, and beautiful surface, pan flat.
My kind of cycling. I think we had a headwind. I couldn't quite tell. We'll find out on the way back, no doubt. This is the cafe at the Tour of Flanders Museum. We'll go in and have a look around the museum shortly. But this is a, you know, a place that's a real homage to professional cycling. There's a huge picture of Alpe d'Huez on the wall. Lots of photographs from the 1920s, 30s and 40s. Lots of jerseys up on the wall. My particular favourites from... the 1987 Tour de France, the Combine jersey, which is an amalgamation of the polka dot jersey, the yellow jersey and the green jersey. And thank you very much. Our coffees have just arrived, and a quick look at the menu tells us that there's a Russian coffee, the Andrei Schmil Russian coffee. He won several classics, including Milan San Remo, Tour of Flanders. There's the Cappuccino Claudio Chiappucci, the Irish coffee Sean Kelly, which I'm sure... Sean would appreciate. It's got alcohol in it. and the Tay Mark Cavendish, a Mark Cavendish tea. I'm not sure, maybe that's because they think the English drink tea, perhaps. I don't know whether Mark's a tea drinker, I'm not sure about that. Anyway, we're going to take a look around the museum in a minute after we've finished our coffees. So, just about to enter the Tour of Flanders Museum. Very good value, €8. As you walk down the steps to the bottom, there are old newspaper front pages from Het Nieuwsblad, the newspaper that pretty much runs the Tour of Flanders, founded the Tour of Flanders, in fact. It was Carol van Wijnendaele who started the Tour of Flanders, I'm pretty sure I'm right in saying. And posters of Fabian Cancellara, Tom Boonen, and Stijn de Volder, the recent winners. And just through the door here, it's basically, it's like a sort of Santa's grotto for cycling fans. Memorabilia, jerseys, facts and figures. A lot of it in Flemish or French, but we've got the English translation on a sort of telephone device, so if you're an English speaker and you don't understand Flemish, then certainly you can come and enjoy the museum.
I had my cobble experience last year, but
there's more to the cobbles than the Tour de France cobbles, the Paris-Roubaix cobbles. So we're stood watching some footage on one of the screens, a sort of mid to late 70s Tour of Flanders. They're riding up the Koppenberg, very steep cobbled climb. Oh dear, rider coming to grief there, toe clips, shoes stuck in the toe clips. Yeah, it looks like us struggling there. Riders falling onto the grass verge. Another rider there with his bike over the shoulder, cyclocross style, running up the hill. That still happens these days in the Koppenberg, particularly very, very steep. And because it's cobbled, yeah, it's difficult to keep the traction and keep moving forward. Yes, and if it's wet, this footage we're watching here is from the mid 80s. The riders at the front tend to get over no problem, but then as congestion further back, it's pretty much every man for himself, a few riders on the deck there, pushing their bikes, walking up. All part of the theatre, of course. And this here we're watching is a very famous incident in 1987 where Jesper Skibu, the Danish rider, was away in the front of the race. He came to a halt, fell over, and then the commissaire's car behind rode over his back wheel. Oh, well, now I'm sitting on one of the static bikes hooked up to a computer which is simulating the climb of the Quarnamont, which we're going to do to tomorrow, I think. Now we've spent too long having lunch and a beer to get out to the Quarnamont today. I'm not going very quickly, and it feels a lot harder than the Quarnamont, to be honest. I don't think I'm going to be setting any record times here.
Got a good pace going. Early days, though, isn't it?
There's still quite a long way to go. I've set off too fast.
5%. Working up to 9%.
Yeah, it feels like it's getting a bit harder now. Oh, I'm way behind Peter van Petergem, winner of the Tour of Flanders and Paris-Roubaix several times. I've still got about a kilometre and a half to go. This was a bad idea. Well, that was a stupid idea. Officially, the computer tells me that I rode the Col de Quarnamont slower than Peter van Petergem, but I really didn't need a computer to tell me that. So, like the Tour de France, which was started by L'Auto, the French newspaper, and like the Giro d'Italia, which is so closely linked to La Gazzetta dello Sport, it was also journalists who started the Tour of Flanders. Carol van Wijnendaele was basically a sports journalist for Sport World, which became was taken over by Het Nieuwsblad. And in 1913, he wanted a bike race, not just to promote the newspaper, but also to reflect the character of the Flandrian people. And it says here in the museum that the character of the race did reflect the people, in that it was tough, incredibly tough, particularly in 1913, riding on those old bikes across what would have been almost unmade roads in a lot of places. You know, we think of the cobbles today, you know, there's no real reason for those cobbles to be still in place, but part of the reason that they still exist on the famous climbs is because of the Tour of Flanders race, and if they were to be tarmacked, the race's character would change completely. So Karel van Wijnendaele, he started the Tour of Flanders, and now, what, 101 years on, we're reflecting on one of the greatest one-day races on the calendar, and for me anyway, probably the most enjoyable race to visit, simply because the hills are so close to one another. It's possible to get out and ride half a dozen or more hills on a single day, and I think Carol's vision certainly lives true today. The race reflects the character of the people, because the, you know, the Tour of Flanders comes alive in the bars and on the roadside. One wall of the museum is dedicated to all the winners of the Tour of Flanders, right back to 1913, the first winner, Paul de Man. But it's the 1961 race, which I suppose is how I discovered the Tour of Flanders, reading about it when I was growing up, because Tom Simpson won it. And I remember watching it on the TV, probably would have been Eurosport at the time in the early 90s, and just being captivated by this race. I'd read about it, I'd seen photographs, but actually to see the race on television for the first time. And I was struck really reading the accounts of Tom Simpson's victory in 1961, just what a different race it was back then. Now we're accustomed to there being 16 or 17 hills in the race, and it's all about the difficulty of those hills which creates the winners. But in 1961, when Tom Simpson won, there were only six hills. That doesn't mean that it was an easier race, far from it, but it just shows you that the character of these races has evolved and changed over time.
Met Fagnini, met Schmil, met Sproeg, is dat Dierksens, Guidi, Job, nee, wie is dat hier allemaal? Dat zijn andere mannen, met Fontanelli.
Also in the museum, they've got some of the old bikes that have been ridden in the Tour of Flanders, and the ones from the 60s and 70s, I've just picked them up, which you're probably not supposed to do, but I was very careful. And I was staggered by the weight of them compared to our modern bikes these days. They're considerably heavier. There's even Eddie Merckx's bike from 1972, which is a little bit lighter than the ones that have gone before it. It's still heavier than my winter bike that I'm riding today, with its mudguards and alloy frame. So that gives you an indication of just how hard it was to be, you know, an elite cyclist then. We talk about the great strides forward in performance. It's not just the athletes that have honed techniques and nutrition and preparation have evolved and changed over the years. The equipment the riders are riding these days is streets ahead of what Eddie Merckx was riding 40 years ago. The first Tour of Flanders I remember watching on TV was the 1991 edition, which was won by Edwig van Hooydonk, and it was his second win in 3 years, and he was nicknamed Eddie Bosberg because that's where he basically laid the foundations for his victories on the Bosberg, the final climb of the race. And by 91 there were 14 hills, and it's looking much more like the Tour of Flanders that we know today, starting in that year in Saint Nicolas and finishing in Merlebeke, which is near Ninove. And the final two climbs were the Mur, the Kappel Mur in Gerardsbergen, and the Bosberg. And, you know, when I rode the Tour of Flanders Sportive for the first time in, I think, 2000 or 2001, that was more or less the route that we covered, going over all of the famous climbs like the Ol de Quadamont, the Pattersberg, Eikenberg, the Lieberg, and the Meutlenberg before you get to those final two climbs. And it's the repetitive nature of those climbs that wears the legs, even if you're riding it just in the Sportive. By the time you've done six or seven of the climbs, you're really beginning to feel it. And then as you push on towards the end, the energy levels are running down, and that's where the real tough guys come to the fore. And that's what makes the race, you know, one of endurance, really, and just not just tactical strategy, but it's just who's able to make the moves and mark the moves when the race comes down to the final few hills. And it's probably why a lot of the time we see the winning moves go clear on the flat roads between the hills, because everybody's watching everybody else on the hills, and it's those moments of inattention between the climbs where the moves can sometimes go away and stick. In true museum style, you have to exit through the gift shop. Could spend a fortune in here on the old jerseys and some of the books as well, but I'm on my bike, so I can't really carry it back to the hotel. That saved me from lightening my wallet a bit today. So we better get back on the road. It's nearly 3 o'clock now, probably an hour back to Ghent. We're going to be losing the light if we're not careful.
Up, 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 up.
So we finished our ride, we're back at the hotel. We didn't make it down to the Quarnemont or the Paterberg or the Koppenberg because we spent too long in the museum, but we'll head out there tomorrow. Now though, it's back to the track.
The Telegraph Cycling Podcast. Subscribe on iTunes, listen on Audioboo, visit us at thecyclingpodcast.com.
The second night of the 6 day, and I've been watching from the seats this evening rather than down in the track centre. You get a much better perspective of how all the racing is panning out. Kenny de Ketteler and Jasper de Buist are still in the lead, but the big story here today is that of the cat that got onto the track last night and nearly caused a pile-up, nearly got run over, nearly used up one of its 9 lives. Well, today, for the Telegraph Cycling Podcast, a big exclusive for you. I've managed to catch up with the cat, and I had some questions to ask him about what he thought he was doing. Can you tell me what you thought you were doing running onto the track? Don't interrupt. Can you tell me what you thought you were doing running onto the track during a cycling race? I'm expecting an answer here. Have you nothing to say for yourself? Well, that's not really good enough, is it?
The Telegraph Cycling Podcast. Interviews and analysis. We've got the big talking points covered.
So we've just ridden the Alde de Quarnemont. We're at the main road at the top of the climb, mercifully off the cobbles. Simon Gill, your day job's a photographer, keen cyclist, but this is your first experience of the cobbles. What did you make of them?
Cobble virgin, but no longer. Shuddering and... yeah, interesting. I remember got booed by yourself for taking a five meter breather. Yeah. And yeah, and here we are at the top, and kind of enjoyable, but kind of not, obviously. So,
well, that's the longest climb in the Tour of Flanders, the Alde de Quarnemont, 2.2 kilometres from bottom to top. All but the first section is cobbled. Yeah. I did boo Simon when he took a bit of relief on the on a bit of drainage. They've basically got sort of smooth sections on some of the curbs, and you can sort of hop off the cobbles and get a bit of a break from the juddering. The riders in the Tour of Flanders do that, so it's not cheating, but you know.
It's a bit cheating, but
well, we've got two more goes to come.
Excellent.
If you thought that was tough, wait till you see the Paterberg and the Koppenberg, which are the next two climbs.
Right. Hop, hop, hop.
So we were riding along just towards the Alde de Quarnemont, and a car overtook us and then pulled in at a lay-by, and the driver got out, and I thought he was going to have a go at us for riding three abreast or two abreast, two and a bit abreast, perhaps, because there wasn't a cycle lane on that stretch of road. But he sort of flagged us down and we pulled in, and then he said something to us in Flemish, and then he was pointing to Andy's mudguards, and he wanted to know what they were and where he could get some from. So mudguards, obviously not a thing in Belgium.
Obviously not, yeah. He was quite bemused. He said, you know, where can I get some of these? And I said, well, you know, any reputable bike shop, of course, would sell you a set of those.
Perhaps a bike loft in Redbourne would sell him a set of those, mail order?
Yeah, we've definitely got plenty of mudguards in stock at the moment for the winter season. But yeah, he was most surprised. And what are these, he said, you know, and yeah, where can I get some? So we pointed him in the direction of the internet.
You would think that with all the sort of mud and the amount of rain they have over here, mudguards would be one of the first things that the Belgians would have discovered, but clearly not. So there we are.
Maybe there's so much mud that we haven't had any problems today, but maybe, you know, the mudguards would just get clogged up.
That's highly possible, indeed.
Hop, 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 hop!
Oh, so, we've ridden the Paterberg, the second of our very mini Tour of Flanders taster for Cobble's first timer, Simon. He's equipping himself very well, king of the mountains on that one, although you have the build of a mountain goat, and arguably Andy slightly overgeared on the 39 tooth.
Overgearing, but, well, I suppose it's fair enough.
It is fair enough, yeah. You were saying, Andy, as soon as you got out of the saddle, try and get on top of the gear, back wheel slipping. Good job it's not wet.
Yeah, excellent job that it's not wet. If it was, I'd be probably on the floor by now. But just about managed to get the gear round up there. But mercifully, a very short climb.
It is. It's, 375 metres, 20% that bit around two-thirds of the way through. So just to, and the hardest thing about it is you're coming off a quite a nice descent into a completely dead right-hand turn. So you've got to really, you lose all your momentum taking the corner. You go into the climb with absolutely no momentum. We were talking, well, I was talking in the Tour of Flanders Museum yesterday about how these Belgian races really reflect the character, not only the people but the countryside. And it's a bright November day. It's cold, and the trees are kind of, most of them have lost their leaves. The fields have kind of closed down for the winter, just a crop of stubble in front of us. But yeah, it's the dead concrete roads, the wind, the cold in the air, the occasional lung full of manure or dung, which sort of just makes you realise you're outdoors. And the cobbled roads, I mean, unnecessarily so, really. They could tarmac this perfectly easily.
Yeah, exactly. It's ridiculous, really. But it's a very harsh environment, which does have some kind of bizarre sadomasochistic beauty and charm to it that perhaps maybe only as a cyclist you see that.
And would that be the factory that you were talking about earlier, Lionel, where you do a stop for the Tour of Flanders Sportif?
Yeah, a couple of years ago, when it lasted the Tour of Flanders Sportif. This sums up Belgium as well. Everything is about commerce and money and industry, really. Graft, I suppose. You see it at the sixth day, you know, all the sponsorship logos all over the track. You know, everything has got a price. And that's kind of the roots of Belgian cycling, really. And so no real surprise that when we did the Sportif, one of the feed zones was in a warehouse. And they made us get off our bikes, walk through the warehouse, past all of this kind of workwear. So luminous jackets, hard hats, labourer's boots. And they gave us flyers as well. Perhaps they thought maybe we'd be in the market for some of that gear. And they made us do all that before we were able to pick up an energy gel. And I suppose it just shows that cycling is a vehicle for commerce and advertising, really, even at a sportive level.
Hop, 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 hop.
We made it to the top of the Koppenberg, the third of our three climbs, probably the hardest, not a lot steeper than the Paterberg, probably only 1% in it, but the cobbles are in worse condition. There's a lot more mud and grass in between, and as Simon said, at times you're caught between the back wheel slipping and the front wheel lifting up, so you're doing a wheelie. I've got plenty of weight to get over the back wheel, but even then, it's a job to stop the front end lifting up. You can't really get out of the saddle, can you, either? Because
definitely not. No. It just slips every time you get out, and then you sit back down again, and then you're doing wheelie, and then you hit a, and then you hit a big crack, and then a bit of grass, and then you swear a little bit, and then thankfully it's pretty short, so you can see the end, and it just kind of levels out and gets a bit easier, and here we are.
Lunch is beckoning, yeah. Quite a nice view up here today. It's a bit hazy, but you can see a little village over there. It's very peaceful, nobody about at all. It feels almost like the countryside's deserted today, which has made it nicer cycling. So we're off for lunch and then back up the canal to Ghent, and that will be our little 2-day Tour of Flanders done and dusted.
Up, 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 up.
You're listening to the Telegraph Cycling Podcast. Tweet us at cycling_podcast.
It's Thursday night at the Ghent 6 Day. The weekend starts here. The crowd is even bigger than it's been earlier in the week. The queues at the bar are longer. The atmosphere is louder and more intense. It's hotter. Everything about it is gearing up for the weekend. Unfortunately, this is my last night here. But before I go, I've been able to talk to Simon Cope, who's looking after A couple of the young British riders who are in the under 23 race, that's Chris Lawless and Matt Gibson. They're leading after three nights. I also caught up with Shane Archbold, the Kiwi rider, a member of Sean Kelly's road team. He's here riding the sixth day with Glenn O'Shea, the Australian, and I asked him what the atmosphere is like from the perspective of a rider on the track. I'm with Simon Cope from British Cycling, who's looking after a couple of the under 23 riders in the UIV Cup, which is basically an hour long, hour and a half long, each night, 6 day for under 23 riders. And it's Chris Lawless and Matt Gibson. They were leading after the second night. How's things gone tonight?
It's gone pretty well tonight. They're still leading by 2 points, which is always good. Matt didn't have such a good night, had a bit of a tight chest and that, so had to look after him there. But they're both riding strong, considering Matt's still 17, and Chris, I think, is still 18. If he is 19, it's not by much, but I think his actual birthday's December. I should know, but it's good actually for considering, you know, a lot of the field are up to 23 really.
It's become quite a key event in the development of young British riders. I remember Mark Cavendish, Geraint Thomas riding here. Pete Kennock and Adam Blythe won together in 2007. Why is it good for them at such a young age to kind of come and mix it on a tight track? Is it all about, as Rod Ellingworth would say, learning the skills and drills?
It is. I was talking to Cav earlier, actually, just about, you know, doing the sixes as a, you know, like, let's say, an amateur. It is about learning the skills and drills and this sort of fast racing. It's, you know, you've got to make split decisions. So, you know, it's good. Plus, it's about the discipline as well. You know, every morning they're out on the road for between 2 and 3 hours. Weather dependent, but, you know, even if it's raining, they're still out there. A lot of these other teams spend 20 minutes on the rollers, and it's like a mini training camp as well, you know. A few hours on the road in the morning, race in the evening, it gets you into the swing of it, really.
I mean, people might be amazed at that, that, you know, they're racing pretty hard. It's intense racing, and they've got a couple of hours, admittedly only easy craps, is it, in the morning on the road, but, you know, the amount of work that they're getting through, I mean, is that what just takes them on to the next level, just having these blocks of intense work?
It is. It's just about the building blocks and the discipline. You know, you don't get to be a top-class rider without putting the work in, and this is teaching them that, you know, you can still race a little bit fatigued. I always think that's a good thing, because you make, you know, decisions, you know, based on how you're feeling rather than just on emotion, as it were. So, yeah, it's definitely the way to go.
So there's a limit to what you can learn just on your own talent and being fresh. It's when you're under a little bit of stress, when you're perhaps not feeling 100%, that you're going to learn more about yourself, I guess.
I think you do, yeah, definitely. You know, I mean, it's learning, you know, like in the Tour, you've got to race tired, haven't you? You know, and it's about saving that energy and using it when you need it, basically.
Now, I remember back sort of 10, 15 years ago when British Cycling was accused of kind of abandoning road racing entirely and focusing everything on trying to win medals on the track. It seems now that there's a real harmony, and that the track and the road works hand in hand now.
Oh, it does. One complements the other. I mean, when you look at what Brad's done in his career, you know, he's won the Tour. He's been individual champion, team champion, time trial champion. I mean, I don't know. Is there another all-rounder that's done that, really? I mean, I know Anquetil was a pursuiter and a time trialist, Tour winner. But a lot of the, if you look at a lot of the good, the Tour riders started off as pursuiters. I think the track definitely has got good building blocks for the road.
And finally, for you as a coach, you're stood on the sidelines. You're giving little messages to the riders. What is it you can do to try and influence them? Are you just trying to reinforce positive messages, or are you actually coaching them through each of the race sessions?
It's a bit of both, really. I mean, obviously, I can see what's happening down the back end of the bike race with their opponents. I mean, there's times where you'll give them instructions that, you know, you need to commit for a couple of laps because a team close to you on the classifications, like half a lap down, and then also just, you know, sort of encouraging them when they hit out for a sprint, you know, just how much distance they've got over, because obviously they're hurting. A bit of both, really, a bit of encouragement and a bit of coaching, really.
And how do you go about putting together a partnership? Because there has to be that level of intuition between two completely different individuals, I guess.
Yes, there is. I mean, I think one of the best ones that worked, really, was myself and Lizzie Armistead at the Worlds one year, where it was just all hand signals. And she knew, when I sort of gave a certain hand signal, she knew what was, you know, what that was for. And she had a successful Worlds that year.
And very finally then, obviously the goal is to try and win, of course, but is it purely result orientated, or are you looking for other things deeper than just a classification?
No, it's not. It's not result orientated at all. It's about coming here and learning. Always nice to win, and the lads want to win. But in some ways, actually, you want them to make mistakes so they learn. So, yeah, it's a tough one, really. I mean, it's not. We haven't come here result orientated. For any of the development stuff, we don't go anywhere result orientated at all. That's Podium's job. The academy is about learning.
Presumably makes your job a little bit less pressured in that sense, maybe.
Yes and no, because, you know, you do get it sometimes in the neck that they haven't got these skills. You might have missed something. So, yeah, but you still, the pressure's there to make sure you get the job right, to send them to the next programme, basically.
Jane, if you had to explain a six-day to someone who's never ridden one before, how would you explain it?
A complete not a miss. No, it's quite easy. It's just like your normal road tour. There's a general classification, there's a winner of each race, and there's a winner of each day. Like, obviously we don't wear jerseys like the Tour de France or anything like that, but it's the exact same principle. It's the best person over 6 days, not the best person on any one night, so...
And what sort of toll does it take on you as an athlete? I mean, you're out here every night. It goes on till 1 o'clock in the morning, 2 o'clock in the morning at the weekend. I mean, you've got to be... You're full on all the time, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a lot harder than anyone thinks. You know, a lot of people talk about 6 days. It's about riding around in circles and putting on a show. But it's nothing like that at all. I mean, I was toast after first night, and still 5 more nights to go, you know, and... it's hard work. Every race is race. Hard, small gears. So coming off like the team's pursuit training or road training, it's definitely not easy. But it's good fun.
How did it fit into your preparation for things like? I mean, there's a Track World Cup in London coming up. The Track Worlds at the end of the winter. Is it beneficial, or is it? You know, did it take a bit of adjustment?
I won't know this year. I'm not actually racing any track races this season. This is my only race. This winter, and after this, I'm concentrating on road preparation for next year, but hopefully for the road preparation it works out well and all comes off.
And in terms of, I mean, I've been here 3 nights now, the atmosphere is starting to do my head in a bit with the music and it gets into you. I've been humming this one late at night. How do you sort of block that out, or do you block that out, or do you just kind of go with it?
You take it all, won't you? It's part of the racing, you know. If there was no music or no spectators, it'd be impossible to do this type of thing. This is what keeps the vibe up. But it is hard. 6 nights in a row going from 2 in the morning, 1 in the morning, everything like that. So.
And lastly, just in your little cabins there, I mean, I had a visit into one of the cabins on the first night. It's not the most glamorous space, is it? It's a hard night's work, isn't it? It's not, as you say, it's not just like a bit of fun, is it?
Obviously, the spectators are the ones that bring the money in, and they're the paying customers, so they get all the luxuries. The old cabin's pretty small. We've got a bucket to piss in, and Swan Yours to wipe us down. Me and Glenn are sharing a cabin with Andreas, an Austrian, so it's even tighter than normal. Normally, it's the 2 people. We've got 1-3, so it's close quarters, but it's all part of the racing. It's your teammate. It's fun, you know. It's what happens.
Well, that's it from the Ghent 6 Day. There's 3 more days of racing still to go, but I'm heading home tomorrow. You can catch up on all the results on the internet. If this podcast has whetted your appetite for track racing, there are still tickets available for the London World Cup from December the 5th to the 7th at www.ticketmaster.co.uk/British Cycling. This has been a Telegraph Cycling Podcast. My name's Lionel Birnie. Our editor for this episode is John Mooney. Thank you very much for listening. We'll be back to normal next week with Richard and Daniel.
The Telegraph Cycling Podcast. Subscribe on iTunes, listen on Audioboo, visit us at thecyclingpodcast.com.